Kia ora, morena, kia ora te whānau, tēnā koutou, tēnā tātou katoa, namaskar, deobore dis. Greetings all and welcome to the session about Indigenous perspectives on decolonial futures with Professor Yin Paradies. Ko Ruth de Souza tōku ingoa, I'm a nurse by background, a podcaster and a researcher. I'm a former Aucklander or Jaffa, now living on the unceded lands of the Bunurong on the Bass Coast of Victoria. My ancestors are from Goa, India. My grandparents migrated to Tanzania, my parents to Kenya and then Aotearoa. I'm continuing that tradition and migrated to Australia from Aotearoa. As is the custom here where I'm speaking from on the lands of the Kulin Nation, let me begin by acknowledging the Bunurong language group on whose ancestral land I stand and whose waterways and skies I'm privileged to view from the window just over my screen. I pay tribute to the ancient cultures, knowledge, strength, and resilience of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples, despite the profound trauma and intergenerational trauma of European invasion of their unceded lands, which rightfully belong to the Wurundjeri, Bunurong, Wathaurong, Tungurong, and Dja-Dja-Wurrung peoples. I celebrate the sovereign future of all Aboriginal people of the Kulin Nations and acknowledge their elders past and present. It always was and it always will be Aboriginal land. I've just been listening to Ani Makaere's Kōrero on constitutional transformation and how we go beyond acquiring te reo or doing a land acknowledgement. Are we willing to give up power, being solid allies or accomplices, or are we participating in cultural appropriation or the logics of genocide and elimination? I ask if a land acknowledgement that merely reminds us or the audience that land has been stolen is adequate without a corresponding obligation to take action. Or are we merely saying, I stole the land, but I'm keeping it? I love how the Pepeha asks us to account for our positionality. As a migrant of colour, I'm implicated in what Chatterjee terms how the capitalist colonial project of simultaneous dispossession of Indigenous people and precarious incorporation slash resettlement of immigrants operates in Australia, or how the Indigenous and the diasporic are pitted against each other as Indigenous rootedness and diasporic placelessness. It's a time in the world where there's heightened awareness of settler colonialism in its most accelerated, indifferent, and genocidal form, as we are watching in Gaza. It's a time in Aotearoa where the government wants to roll back the gains that tangata whenua have made in terms of treaty, language, and culture. And yesterday was 5 years since the massacre of innocent Muslims in Christchurch. In Australia, deaths in custody continue and inequitable health outcomes. So these conversations that we're having across the waters about racism this weekend are critically important. I'm hoping that they cause trouble. I'm a troublemaker. Donna Haraway said in 2016 that trouble comes from a 13th century French verb meaning to stir up, to make cloudy, to disturb. They said, we live in disturbing times, mixed up times, troubling and turbid times. The task is to become capable with each other and all of our bumptious kinds of response. Mixed up times are overflowing with both pain and joy, with vastly unjust patterns of pain and joy, with unnecessary killing of ongoingness, but also with necessary resurgence. So we are here to talk about what we do with the trouble. And I've got another troublemaker here, but maybe Yin wouldn't call themselves that, but we'll see. It's my pleasure to introduce Professor Yin Paradies, who describes himself as an animist, anarchist, activist Wakaya man, who's committed to understanding and interrupting the devastating impacts of modern societies. That's troublemaking, I think. He seeks mutuality of becoming and embodied kinship with all life to transform ways of knowing, being, and doing. Yin is the chair in race relations at Deakin University, where he conducts research on racism and anti-racism. He also teaches and undertakes research in Indigenous knowledges and decolonization. He's authored a lot of publications, written a lot of grants, and has a very high Google H index. Very scholarly man, and is also going to talk to us about praxis today. And in this workshop, we're going to explore colonial, patriarchal, capitalist modern societies alongside Indigenous perspectives, worldviews, and existence-scapes. I'm so excited about hearing from Yin today. And just before I hand over to him, I'm going to just talk you through some housekeeping very quickly. We've got a community code that will come on the screen. Here it is. So this is an invitation to be curious, open, respectful, make generous assumptions, maintain confidentiality, have one person talking at a time, speak about your own experience. Remember that no one knows everything, but together we know a lot. Make space, take space, and just remember we can't be articulate all the time and don't take ourselves too seriously. Please feel free to use the chat. We've got some accessibility info on the screen here. If you click on that link, you'll be able to access live captions. Please also use the Q&A for all your questions. And what we'll do is make sure we've got 10 minutes at the end for questions. I'll hand over to you now, Yin.
Thank you, Ruth. I will start by acknowledging my brothers and sisters, the Wurundjeri Woiwurrung peoples of the Kulin Nations, whose lands I live on, work and play. And yes, I'm definitely hoping to be a troublemaker, a trickster even, if we can organise that. Let's start with some slides though. From the start. So I will be talking about this topic, Indigenous perspectives on decolonial futures. I've got a few slides, I've got a few words on them, but we should have plenty of time for discussion at the end. And also feel free to pop questions in the chat as we go, and we'll get to those at the end as well. So basically, to start with, the trouble that we need to bring is to trouble our understandings of the world that we live in already. The world that we live in already, as Ruth mentioned, it's a settler, patriarchal, capitalist, colonialist context. And some people just call this modernity. And this is a very useful diagrammatic representation of that. By the way, I'll post all these slides at the end, and you can see the sources for various aspects of the presentation. So modernity is about global capital, nation states, separability, universal reason, these sorts of things. It's a separation very much into the haves and the have-nots, the global north, the global south. And the whole house of modernity is subsidized and maintained by ongoing forms of violence, some more obvious, some less obvious. We get from modernity things like the classic Cartesian statement, I think, therefore I am, but other things such as other sayings, other pithy sayings like, I say, therefore it is, I own, therefore I rule, I lead, therefore you follow, I arbitrate, therefore you comply, and I rock, therefore you suck. These are very convenient summaries of the way our society works. Society that is about very much about knowing, meaning, and very much marginalizes other forms of being in the world, such as the erotic, the aesthetic, the intuitive, the divine, the hilarious, and of course the other than human. So modernity is about fears, it's about desires, compensatory desires, harness fears, things like certainty, coherence, consensus, control, mastery, authority, validation, and entitlements, very much about entitlements. We'll talk more about this in upcoming slides. But if you wanted to go to a one-stop shop for this sort of stuff, this is a great diagram of that. And the point about the house of modernity is it's breaking down, there's structural damage, and the question is what to do about that. Do we fix, expand, build another house, consider other forms of shelter that maybe are more sustainable? So one of the things, I've got a few slides with some M alliterations going on here. So maladies of modernity. Essentially, what are the key features of the societies that we live in today in the modern world? And we'll talk about a few of those, and then we'll contrast them with perhaps other ways that people have lived in the past and continue to live in small pockets currently to some degree. Some of the maladies of modernity, or features, if you will, are things like quantification, valuation and objectivity, rationalism and reductionism, continuity and determinism, standardization and systemization, weaponization, actual weapons, and also weaponizing behaviors and words and practices, and instrumentalization. So the treating of all those resources, whether they're human or non-human, including within our relations, our kinship and friendship and work relations. Abstraction, anonymity, modularity, so breaking things up into compartmentalized forms, and force, which is related to forms of violence which underpin systemic kind of concentrated, intensified forms of violence that underpin and maintain the system. So we also have mannacles of modernity, which are things like separation from ourselves, from other people, from other beings, from land, country, sea and sky, which denies the interdependence and vulnerability that we have with each other and with the world. Forms of unrestricted autonomy. So autonomy is not a bad thing, but we have a bit much of it, a bit unrestricted, not relational. As we mentioned in the diagram, entitlement, concepts of merit and innocence, and really a denial of complicity in harm, violence and exploitation that underpin our societies. Of course, unceasing growth is an economic model of modernity. Progress is a very deep mythos that we work with. Accumulation, acquisition, consumption and waste, which denies the finite biosphere, the one world that we actually live in. I mentioned already certainty, surety, mastery, control. It's in that diagram. And these tend to create simplistic solutions to complex predicaments that we are facing at the moment, tremendous challenges. Look, things like greenwashing and renewable energies are simplistic solutions to much deeper problems. Malaises of modernity are things like artificial scarcity and demand, profit accumulation, hierarchies that are ossified, fossilized hierarchies, individualism as a kind of a ethos, exploitation, competition, commodification of everything, along with forms of comparison, judgment, condemnation, and alienation. Lots of cynicism, craving, fear, anxiety, blame, guilt, shame, greed, stress, disgust, horror, anger, frustration, boredom, desperation, stimulation, and satisfaction. Some of those are perfectly fine in balance. Some of them are fairly unique to modernity, and all of them can be challenging. Once again, it's never too late to mention more control, conformity, coercion, compliance, cruelty. These are very fundamental features of modern societies, the ones that we live in. Purity, protagonism, progress, protest, and popularity are also very, keep us very busy in one form or another, one of those sorts of things, a balance of those things. So the mediocrity of modernity is really that essentially there's better ways to live in the world. And humans mostly have been living on this beautiful planet in better ways for 95% of our history, 99% of our ancestors didn't live in this way. They lived in different ways, which we could call indigenous or primal, and we'll talk about what those look like in a minute. So basically the story is modernity is not that great. There is a kind of sense that from some pundits that everything is awesome, nothing's ever been better. I would tend to disagree. I would say modernity does not entail that much soft fascination, appreciation, awe, eroticism, sensuality, intensity, desire, and pleasure, and we could have more of those things. And those sort of things could actually animate our actions, sustain our solidarity, rather than these polarities of good, bad, sickness, health, or efficiency, sustainability. What about the actual intensities, the emergences of life? And this kind of experiential aesthesis or sensation-based approach, being present, connecting with the world, it can be commodified, but at a certain bandwidth, it's sort of beyond the consumerism of modernity. It can get to that point. Doesn't always happen. We've also got, the meltdowns of modernity. This is kind of an important point. Can be challenging to hear. The thing about civilizations, and civilizations themselves are kind of very modern ideas, they have certain life cycles, just like everything in the world. We're coming to the end of the life cycle of this particular civilization. So the uneven but irreversible ending of industrial consumer modes of existence, that's sustenance, shelter, health, security, pleasure, identity, meaning, all the stuff of life, basically embedded in a matrix of industrial consumer modes at the moment. That's coming to an end. The decline of that began about 2015. We know from the statistics in relation to crop yields, quality of life, life expectancy, health, income, education, trust in government, energy return on investment, resource availability, these sorts of things. And essentially, as detailed in this book, we should see the end of industrial consumer modes by about 2030, sometime in that decade, which is the next decade, of course. At the same time, we're dealing with sixth mass extinction, which is, of course, caused by the same form of modernity. That could be potentially a lot worse than simply the end of this particular civilizational mode of being. Hopefully not. Hopefully ecosystems will rebound when humans stop doing silly stuff. That will happen at the end of the industrial consumer society's demise. Coming up soon. So beyond modernity's mastery, what if we stopped fixing, forcing, and yoking the inherent vastness and radical incoherence of life, and instead embrace the mystery of their unfoldment? Once again, this is moving from a very modern mindset to a very primal mindset, to engage in emergences that spill away from our containment, outside our rational control. Caesuras, that's like a kind of a break in Latin, without clear channels that eschew the perpetual antagonism of resistance and the escape of refusal. Moving beyond these polarities of modernity. Perhaps passivity is a receptive relinquishment. So a sort of, how can we be receptive to the cosmos is the question, in a way that's conducive to change, but isn't specifically about forcing, fixing, creating change from ourselves. It's a more than human mindset in many ways. Where can we draw wisdom that isn't from our own simple rational control? Okay, oh, I'm having trouble here, sorry. Primal perspectives, yes. So I use the word primal. It's kind of like indigenous, but I don't want to get caught up really in identity politics. I'm talking about the way, as I said, humans have lived for 95% of our history, or 99% of our ancestors, as far as we know. So humans as a species have been around for about 330,000 years. Modernity itself, at the most, is about 10,000-12,000 years old. Things started to change. New, interesting, problematic things emerged about 10,000-12,000 years ago. Things like density of living, agriculture, wars of conquest and invasion, slavery, money, armies, soldiers, kings and queens, these sorts of things that are very familiar to us, but actually were not familiar to people before that time. So people who live in primal ways are about cycles, rhythms. For parts of modernity, that has also been true. Cycles and rhythms have been important, but we're very much stuck in linear time at this point. Clocks are everywhere. So different forms of time. everywhere in time, spatial, slushy, rippled, textured time. It's about and both, holistic alongside either or binary thinking. It's about wisdom, humility, respect, generosity, our ability to respond to our responsibility, with different forms of sensing coming into it as well. Reason, emotion, intuition, instinct, imagination, all mixed together. And primal peoples are very much about communicating with the cosmos. I've mentioned that already. Taking the cosmos as living and communication with all life. So achievements of primal societies are things like vivid, varied, playful, meaningful, exceptionally healthy, well-nourished, virtually disease-free, long, socially and sexually egalitarian lives. So a lot of diseases actually that we have now, that we struggle with now, are creations of modernity, arose during forms of intensive agriculture and so forth. Primal peoples thrive without invasion. So we're talking about wars of conquest and invasion, not really known in primal societies. Without laws, L-O-L-A-W-S, but having law, L-O-R-E. Without money, work as we know it, leisure as we know it, private property, police, institutional authorities, etc. Those are aspects of modernity. The archaeological evidence tells us that the average primal person, pre-modernity at least, was stronger than Olympic rowers, as fast as Olympic sprinters, at ease with natural forces, life, love, death, sex, pain, discomfort, able to craft, sustain and commune, improvise with really quite miraculous skill, sensitivity and presence compared to what we are now capable of as an average member of a domesticated, dependent, modern society. So what are the aspects of these modern societies that seem to work to create really wonderful places to live in sustainable ways that didn't lead to the sixth mass extinction? Some of these aspects are things like eccentricity, individuality, different from individualism, which we can get into, context sensitivity, an absence of inherently oppressive abstracted rules, interdependence, layered, nested, distributed forms of authority and leadership, reflective oral cultures, very much good at keeping memories alive but not written down, so with fidelity over tens of thousands of years, a balance and a blurring between the literal, the metaphorical, the linear spiral time, being, becoming, place and time. Other aspects of primal societies include things like prefigurativity, in which the ends never justify the means. Concepts, ideas flow from deeds, enactments rather than the other way around. And about a knowledge that's about touching the world, essentially, a non-abstract, an embodied, entangled, tactile form of knowledge. Lots of ritual and ceremony as creative repetition, and a lot of practice with death. One of the things about modern societies is we have a morbid fear of death, generally speaking, and that creates all sorts of issues. But primal cultures practice death through fairly intense forms of ritual and ceremony. There's anarcha-Indigenism, so these ideas of, we don't have time to get into these in detail, we can ask more questions at the end. Freedoms of movement and hospitality, to disobey orders, which generally didn't come from others anyway, to vary social configurations, so to have hierarchies that were more fluid. Of course, a connection, a kinship, a hugely important aspect of primal societies is kinship, country or land, memory. Rematriation is about matriarchies, so primal societies are generally speaking, they are weakly matriarchal societies, whereas we live in a strongly patriarchal society, so that makes for very different forms of life. Radical localization, of course, decentralization, no states, and a lot of self-organizing, nested, fractal, organic, edge of chaos, holographic, emergent webs and weavings. So emergence, complex systems rather than linear, command and control, hierarchical, box-like structures. Fierce egalitarianism is a very important feature of primal societies, so that's about autonomy, but not unrestricted autonomy, a relational autonomy. People are free to do as they choose within deep kinship relations. So they have obligations, but there's no orders, there's no command obedience systems, no one's really in charge. And there's downward leveling norms that try and keep egos in check, because egos are one of the great dangers that primal societies identify as problematic and try and keep in check. Guidelines for behaviors, but up to you what you do with those. Profound respect for well-being of yourself and others. So closely related to indigenous or primal perspectives are decolonial perspectives, which are things like this. Nothing is complete, perfect, or enduring, but all is alive, sentient, profoundly relational, and deeply sacred. We are immersed in manifold realms, which we can learn to perceive, inhabit, co-mingle, and grow with. We are invited to outgrow the often unquestioned obligation to obey, conform, judge, and repress, which stunts our ability to express, create, connect, and play. We are called to conscious, embodied, loving, reverent co-liberation with each other within the spontaneous, emergent, complex, self-organizing living cosmos that we are merely extensions of. So decolonial disinvestments would be things like this: ending debt, private property, institutions, nation states, to overcome alienation from ourselves, others, our conditions of life, and so-called nature. Unlearning reductionism, truth, rightness, power over, ambition, affirmation, success, perfection, certainty, control, coherence, mastery, progress, virtue, fame, validation, heroism, merit, entitlement, duty, and sacrifice. Explore ways of becoming, relating, and perceiving that create a life beyond exceptionalism, human exceptionalism, and personal exceptionalism. Exploitation, extraction, consumption, growth, and human hubris and arrogance more generally. The four H's of decolonization, things like profound humility in the face of unfathomable forces, which we are merely extensions of, radical honesty with yourself, mostly with others, where it's safe, constant hyper self-reflexivity, listening to yourself, tuning into yourself, attending, sensing into, resonating with the complexities of emergence from yourself. Expansive sense of humor, the capacity and willingness to laugh and cry at and with life. There's some H's, got some D's as well, seven of them this time. Declutter your being, detoxify your practices. These are really easy to say, but actually take a whole lifetime to organize. Decommission your weapons, disarm your refusals, rejections, and resistances. Desist from both demonization and idealization. Deinvest in addictions, cravings, and compulsions. Decenter your indulgences and misplaced longings, the ones that lead to the addictions and cravings and compulsions in the first place. So decolonization really is about heart and gut-based rather than head-based experiences. I mean, there's a balance there, but there's a lot more heart and gut than we usually do. A shared psychic intertwined existence-scape rather than a narcissistic ego-based world is what we're aiming for, in my view. Dwelling within the eternal spirit substance flow of life rather than the anxiety-ridden, if-then, infinite flowcharting of mere living. Ritual architecting of wondrously unique textural touch-based, you know, touching the world, not text-based. Sensorial portals to the infinite givenness of experience that exists beyond the barrier of thought, separating us from immaculate, manifest, rippling reality. Once again, getting out of the head. You know, some Indigenous elders describe colonists who arrived in Australia as rolling heads. Others described invading settlers as corpses floating through space. Corpses floating through space. Just to give you a sense of the difference between how primal the intensity and expansiveness of which primal peoples feel, and then they see these other people arriving, and they come up with these descriptions because they can sense the restrictive, the constrictive nature of those existences, those colonial existences. Decolonial tips: from form to flow, from saving to shedding, from knowing to noticing, from rights to responsibilities, from go-getting to grief-tending, from entitlements to entanglements, from what we are owed to our own obligations. So other decolonial tips, from rushing to slowing down and perceiving otherwise from doing that, from doing the right things to doing things the right way, from seriousness to lightheartedness, from heaviness to lightness of being, from creating anew and reinventing the wheel to noticing existing wisdom, knowledge, and innovation, from needing everyone in the room and on the same page to repairing and renewing existing relations without the need for agreement or conformity or consensus. What would happen if we embrace the immense joy that comes from forgetting who and what we think we are, and instead sensing the gift of not only being what we imagine ourselves to be? What would that look like to go from an extractive to a regenerative economy, to center caring and sacredness, to center life, to relocalize, to draw down to the local, to feed and grow more than human life, to regenerate, to have a well-being, to participatory democracy, type of, or participatory decision-making type of living? What would happen if we sense global patterns, enacted local responses, seeking a grateful, humble, ethical life that tunes in, heals, creates radical abundance, where ours is about belonging, not ownership? How is that about starving modernity at the same time as seeding alternatives, at the same time as shifting consciousness? What can we do to close loops in expanded commons? What would happen if we abolish stock labor markets, interest, commercial compound interest, banking, subsidies, advertising, commercial advertising, planned obsolescence, and in the whole economy, more or less, redundant trade? There's so many things that just don't make sense that we do. How can we relocalize, draw down? Through volunteering, mentoring, skill sharing, time banking, mutual aid, cooperatives, commons, relinquishing debt, money, private property, hierarchical organizations, rejecting competitive success, and stop being consumptive spectators of our own life. Modernity entices us to consume, to be spectators, to witness, to not participate. What if we did live wildly, in conscious, frugal, simple, sufficient, joyful pleasure instead? What if we stopped trying to solve global problems by scaling up standardized solutions? What would it mean to accept ourselves unconditionally, just as we are, while staying wide open to growth? How can we invite material conditions and social relations which are conducive to life, beauty, and thriving? How can we live with dignity, love, courage, and truth, while opening our hearts to those whose views and actions we profoundly object to? Can we enjoy life's resonances, vibrations, textures, thrummings, roilings, secretions, and emanations as we deepen our vulnerability to the suffering of this world? Last three slides now. There's an invitation to societies that value self-realization, needs, freedom, interdependence, care, love, connection, celebration, beauty, grief, cooperation, without institutionalized exploitative hierarchies, hoarding resources produced by the labor of others. Weaving tapestries of empowered local cooperative communities grounded in anarchy as a political platform, degrowth, wilding, unschooling, permaculture, decolonization, myth, ritual, and ceremony that inspire authentic, creative, thriving, playful, vivid, visceral, plural, messy, mystical, vulnerable, sacred, sensuous, joyful, senseful lives. It's a challenge to stay with your appetites, thoughts, feelings, emotions, moods, desires, sensations, yearnings, longings, yieldings, repulsions, callings, instincts, hunches, inklings, and needs. What are they all from moment to moment? What do they mean? Or whence do they emerge? How do they flow? How are they patterned? Offer yourself in full to the world as it is, without demanding acceptance. Welcome change, transformation, metamorphosis, catharsis, intensity, and rupture, while attending to your limits within any given time, place. Meet others with curiosity, courage, vulnerability, love, honesty, and humility. Sense visceral needs behind actions. Learn and grow with gratitude, connection, and conviviality, while minimizing correction. Attending to beauty, wonder, and grace, especially in dire and deeply violated situations, of which there are many. It's simple, but hard. What would happen if we slow? Pause. Rest. Sleep. Idle. Lull. Shed. Catalyze. Channel. Doula. Delve. Guide. Receive the unknowable. Unexpected. Uncomfortable. Uncertain. Unthinkable. And imperceptible. Make unique mistakes in doing what is needed with maturity, sobriety, and discernment beyond consumption, comfort, convenience, choice, conviction, or complaint. Metabolize, integrate assumptions, aversions, addictions, vices, disguises, habits, triggers, complicities, projections, urges, traumas, idealizations, and ossified dichotomies. Discern, perceive, relate, communicate, become without judgment, comparison, justification, condemnation, narrative, meaning, interpretation, or intellectualization. What if we did things like this, with circles, not lines, dialogue, not hierarchy, empowerment, be humble learners, deep listeners, doing things with each other, as co-liberators rather than representatives. Move at the speed of trust, whatever speed that is. Center lived experience rather than expertise, professional expertise as such. Seek people at the margins. Thank you.
Yin, that was absolutely spectacular, beautiful, and moving. I'm gonna ask everyone to just take three deep breaths to just soak in and appreciate your beautiful words. So let's do that together. Thank you, everybody. I'm going to read you a few of the comments from the chat, Yin, and then we'll move into questions. So, Jane Hinckley says, I'm both awestruck and inspired by this layered corridor. Carl Battenberg says, beautiful, eh? Natalie says, the absolute most powerful corridor I've heard in such a long time. This is so powerful. Lynette says, Ngā mihi, heart and gut based, dwelling with the eternal spirit, Wairua driven, truly resonate. From knowing to noticing, powerful, says Natalia. Kat says, the gratitude I have for bearing witness to this corridor is immense, powerful, stirring, truth honoring, and so, so real. Nui te aroha. Patty says, ai he korero a tāhua. Alejandra says, beautiful korero. Pania says, kia ora, rawa atu e te matanga. Loving your korero. Hope you'll agree to share the recording, it's so powerful. Jane says, I'm going to need to review the session again and read and reread. We're getting lots of hearts and thumbs up and appreciation. Nicholas says, so much wisdom here. Tony Fala says, great wisdom embodied in kōrero, where this learning is lived and emerges out of Indigenous and colonial praxis. Love the respect for humility here and the notion of serving others, not ourselves. Alejandra says, I'll be using those questions for my future writing. Will be great questions to reflect on. Tracy Lee says, Yin's kōrero is inspiring. I'm so grateful. Heather Kame says, love the deep dive into decolonial praxis, e hoa. Marissa says, so grateful for this kōrero, tēnā koe, I te manaaki mai, thank you for sharing. Hearts from Rebecca Sinclair. KJ says, the curse of modernity has infiltrated so many fields that affect us every day. Look at local authorities around Aotearoa trying to control the elements rather than accept and work with them. And so many floods, so many towns and cities facing floods, etc. While I'm reading these out, please feel free to add questions to the Q&A. Pania says, so interesting that those who proclaim themselves as liberals who think government should be out of the picture don't get that this was how Indigenous people lived, thriving without police, prisons, laws. But really, they're only about those who have hoarded the resources of the world, getting to keep them and continue hoarding them. They use the words of freedom to fool others into following them. Heather Kame says, time to write a poetry book. No pressure. Lynette Farero says, sensational, totally scaling deep challenge. He Mihi Nui Yin, thanks for instigating a disruption and a rethread. Rand sends a heart. Heather says, stunning, taking things to the next level. Esther Cowley Malcolm says, talofa Esther says, co-liberators, yes. Jade Tang Taylor says, it's simple but hard. So much truth telling here. Loved learning and unlearning with you in this session, Yin. Kororia Webster says, namihi. Van May sends hearts and claps. Natalia says, I don't usually feel like crying after a conference presentation. Romy Atwell sends hearts. Lynette sends hearts. Lisa, poetry pause primal. Nicola Parks applauds. Pania has hearts and applause. Crikey magnificent, says Julie Timmons. Latoya, kia ora sis, says namihi for this kōrero, powerful. Robert Adams, like a two-edged sword. Cannon says, move at the speed of trust, an essential part of being an ECE kaiako. Got lots of hearts. Any more, truth-telling its finest. Atahua, powerful. And I'm reading these out so you can bathe in this, Yin, in a non-ego way, but in a beautiful way, because, you know, you're talking about the collective, but allowing space for the individual. Love the centering of caring and interdependence, as well as participatory decision-making, says Melissa Peterson. Francis Kendall says, a great reminder to remain open to the views and feelings of our fellow human beings and put ego aside. Yin's also put a link to what they're doing to put the concepts into practice at annamkarahomestead.com.au/retreats.
And the slides are there too now.
The slides, working at the speed of light, not just the speed of trust, the speed of light. And Helena Dalton says, this kōrero dropped deep into my being, an inner resonance of ancient knowing. So I'm going to move to the questions now, and there are quite a few. The first one is from Patty Poa. You've got eight, Yin, so we might just have to find a way to manage them carefully, time-wise, but we're doing pretty good, I think. Patty says, ideologies seem to be a key tool used in politics. How would you deal with ideologies?
Well, yeah, that's a big question. First of all, I would retire politics as we know it. That's the first thing. Ideologies, it's just part of the abstractions of modernity. The ideas themselves, instead of being grounded in practice, being connected to practices that we do with each other collectively, you know. So ideologies are very divisive and very much form part of identitarian politics, and are just worth looking beyond, really, to what we actually do and how we can do together. Do, be, become, relate, perceive. The senses, the connection, the bodily practices, I would say, are much more important than ideologies.
And then there's a... Oh, sorry. And Yin, there's a connected question. What are your thoughts about how we more powerfully speak back to and dismantle the current overpowering creep of the far right in our world? So the strategies might be similar.
Yes, yes, the far right. Well, I really think we need to move beyond this whole left to right business. I think that the left and the right are both wings. The left wing and the right wing are both wings of the same bird. And we need to connect with a different bird. That's probably quite evolutionarily quite distant from that bird. So it all comes back to these ideas or these concepts or these practices of how are we showing up in the world, basically, and how do we show it with others? How can we stay with it, with courage and love at the same time as being strong and assertive in the way we want to flow in the world? And so the far right is, you know, one of those examples of people trying to find their way, the rise of the far right. What are those misplaced longings that people are meeting through engagement in far right groups, for example? How can we connect with those? How can we actually meet people's needs and longings and desires and yearnings in a healthy way through primal practices? How do we do it for ourselves? How do we demonstrate it to others? And it's that humanizing of politics. All politics is about people's needs and how they're trying to meet those. And we connect with those, we can learn about ourselves and others and how to be more together in the world in a healthy way.
Beautiful, Yin. I'm going to combine some questions just because of time. Can you perhaps touch on how you might implement these practices in the neoliberal university? You know, what helps you stay in the system? And I'll just cluster a couple of others, Yin, so you can kind of maybe work across them. How can we transfer this knowledge back into those spheres of power and make them slash us listen? And can you talk more about embodiment or the arts, dancing, music, etc., can form an entry point into decolonial practice? And there's a similar one here around embodied and embedded way in your everyday life. You know, how do you live this way? And tips for overcoming and sitting with the friction that comes from living this way.
Yeah. Yeah. They're all good questions. And they're hard to answer in the abstract. This stuff is very much about taking some core key principles and seeing how they apply in your specific life. You know, it's all about context. Context sensitivity is an enormous part of primal living. So there will be friction. There are very strong, oppressive, institutional, hierarchical structures that we're working within, that we live within, that we're trapped in. And primal living is practices are always going to be escape attempts from those. Some will fail, many will fail. There are gifts of failure. There are unique mistakes we can learn from. But also, every day, there's so many small ways we can show up differently, you know, in ways that are more authentic, that are more egalitarian, that are more prefigurative in our politics. You know, how many times a day can we think, am I doing this as an ends justifies a means thing, or am I really dwelling within the means as something that is healthy in itself? Am I being hierarchical with somebody else? Am I being toxic in some ways? Am I allowing others to be themselves, or am I trapping them in expectations? And same for myself. Am I connecting with my own yearnings and desires and emergences and working with those? And this will create friction with structures. It'll create friction with your own shadow inside of you, your own traumas, your own inner modernity, your own inner critics, always there telling you what to do. Orders, another one to think on, to feel into, to notice, is ordering around. So yes, there are cracks we can find and create and prize open in these systems and plant different seeds in them. Very small, every day, dozens of opportunities to do things slightly differently. And part of that is, yes, very much practices of dancing and singing and painting and drawing and visioning the arts, incredibly important primal practices. Can we draw those in to our lives, regular, rhythmic, repetitive, creative practices? And can we disrupt, you know, how can we bring the trickster to a meeting at work at a neoliberal university? What can we bring that would be on the edge of acceptability in the sense that we'll be actually allowed to do it, but it will be disruptive? Bring the trickster.
Can I combine four questions for you, Yin? So the first one is, the side disciplines have socialized the words we use, e.g. ego, narcissism. And I've heard you use these terms to describe modern behaviors. Can you find another way of describing behaviors that don't perpetuate Western psi knowledge? That's one question. Another one's is around, how can you be decolonial in your research? Someone has asked if they can, how they go about being decolonial in their research as an international student doing their PhD in Aotearoa. That's Simone Phillips. Do you have any resources or guidance? Erina asks, how can we prepare our whānau and community for the huge transition, leaving behind the age of modernity? And Patty says, as Indigenous, it feels like we live in two different worlds. How do you manage walking in those two worlds?
Yes. Okay. Well, I'll say to start with that I'm not really aware of any other good words other than ego and narcissism, which of course are English words from a psych framing. I'm open to suggestions on that one, and please email me about those. The other person, Simone, I think, please email me too. I have other resources and presentations that go into more detail on decolonizing research itself. We do live in, I can't remember all those questions, but I think I'll riff on what I can remember. We do live in transitional liminal times, so it's hard. It's what we can call bridging medicines are needed at this time. We can't simply go primal. We need to bridge where we're at to where we want to go, the world we want to create. And we need to look ahead seven generations to the potential for that to emerge. It's not a in our lifetime type of thing. So it's hard to support a family, community, friends through these times. And as the cracks in the structural fabric of modernity increase, there are more opportunities to see these differences. And we just need to be kind to each other. We will make mistakes. Unique mistakes, even repetitive mistakes. And we need to be kind, we need to be open, heartfelt, humble, but also strong and courageous, and support each other through this, where people have the capacity, where they're at in many ways. We start from where people are at, including ourselves, and we work slowly over time through repetitive, nourishing, rhythmic, ritual, ceremonial practices. And by that I simply mean doing things regularly. That's the very essence of the ritual. It's repetitive. So yeah, what can you bring into your life that you can embed and repeat? It's tough. There's friction, it's hard. We'll fall down, we'll stumble, we'll get up, someone will help us up, and we need to have each other's backs as opposed to backing each other up all the time. It's not about I'm going to take your position and back you up. It's about I'm supporting you as a person in your journey that you're on, and I want your support on my journey. It's going to be a tough few decades coming up for humanity.
Okay, I think we can have a final question, and I'll leave these to you to decide whether you know and how you want to answer them, but we've just got a couple of minutes. One from Osman Mansour. Harari says we fight wars because of stories. Yin gave us a story for peace, made more moving by the power of his poetry. a powerful story of reclaiming our past to have a future and many madnesses of modernity. How do we spread the story? And the second question is, secondary students recently did a haka in protest of the government, which has been seen as inappropriate, yet it is a Māori way of speaking and voicing. Some might say it's unkind. What are your thoughts?
Yes, I'll start with that one. It's not unkind to speak your voice, to be heard, to clearly articulate your grievances, your responses, your triggers, your traumas, your reactions, whatever it is, you know, to speak, to be heard. These are important parts of life. So yeah, a protest against the government is not unkind. I mean, it's just, governments have gotten a lot of things wrong and they continue to, so it just makes sense that you'd want to have a say about that. There's ways of doing it. Of course, not the fact of the thing that makes it unkind. It's the process, once again, the prefigurative politics. How do you do it? Respectfully, with an open heart, with a sense of vulnerability, with a sense of coming with real feeling, without predetermining an outcome, but just process sharing. So I don't know how it happened, but the fact of it itself is not unkind. Yuval Harari has written many things, many of which I disagree with. One of them is the idea that we are aiming for a society of peace. Let me post a link about that. Here's a paper from Tyson Junker Porter on violence. Violence is an inherent fact of human societies and also animal societies and plant societies, just life in general. It's not a problem in itself. As with most things in life, it's about balance. And the balance comes from, as in many primal ways of living, distributive egalitarian approaches to anything. Authority, distributed, nested. Violence, distributed, nested. Authority, ritualized, ceremonialized. Violence, ritualized, ceremonialized. Violence is an expression of the human condition. But it doesn't have to be about murdering thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions of people, creating weapons that are can destroy entire cities at once. It doesn't have to be about that. It can be an expression that mostly means nobody has to die, but sometimes people will die and death is fine. We don't have to be scared of it. So I would suggest reading this paper. It's two parts from Tyson about violence. The different ways it operates in settler versus primal context. Yes, we are creating, we're trying to create a culture that's sustainable, that's respectful, that's humble, that's courageous, that's connected, that's kin. It's a, basically a kinship culture, that primal cultures are kinship based. And when you have kin all over the place, you're careful how you interact with them. But that doesn't mean that the violence goes away. It just becomes weaved into the fabric of a healthy culture.
Thank you. I just left a pause in so I didn't interrupt you. It's my job now to do some thanking. Yin, what an amazing morning you've started us off with. And I know there are lots of people who are going to be carrying your words with them and reading your slides again and watching this presentation again. So thank you on behalf of the over 220 people that have tuned in for giving us much to contemplate, but also to feel and embody with some really incredible ideas about how we can be tricksters, how we can cause trouble, how we can disrupt, how we can expand the cracks that are already showing up, how we can maybe be kind when we ourselves and others make mistakes, and how we can embed and repeat. That's what I'm going to be taking with me. And I know there's a lot more to be said, but I won't say it because I don't want to make you late. Want to thank all the people that joined in today for giving up your Saturday morning. All the volunteers who have made this happen, all the sponsors, you can see them here. There's also an incredible event coming up on the next slide. Encourage you to join in this marathon of short interactive talks from students and graduates who are pushing the boundaries in anti-racism in Aotearoa and internationally. And I'm going to just perhaps finish with some closing words, and you might want to close your eyes and take some deep breaths. And I'm just going to say, may I relax. May we relax. May I feel peace. May we feel peace. May I touch true well-being. May we touch true well-being. And may we all let in the wonder of this world. Thank you, Yin, for a wonderful morning. Thank you, everybody. Please keep watching. There's lots more good stuff happening. And sending lots of love. Aroha nui to everybody.